Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome. Today we'll be looking at the God of all things, the God of all things, the God over all things. So today we'll be looking at God, the supremacy, the sovereignty of God over his creation. And as far as I'm concerned, especially in looking at a lot of the teachings, is to appreciate God, for the Lord to be magnified in our heart, for the Lord to be magnified in all realm of human endeavor. God is just more than the creator of man. God created all things. So the more God makes himself bigger, God doesn't get bigger, is the same yesterday, today, and forever. But our perception of him, our increase in the knowledge of him, as he increases the knowledge, the more we are in a better position to appreciate him, to worship him, to adore him as the God over all things. So the first we start with, so almost every of the pages we'll be going through are things that has to do, not everything from the Bible, but things like all things, over all people, over all flesh, over all nations. I mean, God is the God of all things, because nothing was created that was created that wasn't by him, as John 1 makes us understand. So all things were made by him. Colossians 1 tells us this, that all things were made by. So there was nothing, like in the beginning was the world was with God, and the world was God. All things were made by him, for without him was nothing made that was made. So all things were created by God. Also, Ephesians 4:6 tells us that that's one God. Initially, it started from verse 4, that one Lord, one hope of your calling, one Spirit who is over all, one God and Father who is over all. One God and Father who is over all, through all, and in you all. And I think, of course, this letter was written to the believers in Ephesus, which relates to us as well, believers in Christ Jesus. So God is over all. God is through all. And God is in every one of us, the redeemed of the Lord. And this puts us in a better position to appreciate him, to eulogize him, to have our faith built up that we are not in this world by ourselves. God has not created us to go and take care of ourselves or to deal with life by ourselves. But we have that God who is over us, watching over us, who is through us, walking through us, and who is in us, walking his good pleasure in and through our life. What a joy. As Hebrews 1 also tells us, he upholds all things by the word of his power. So we are looking at the God over all things, the God of all things. So he upholds all things by the word of his power. Hebrews 1, I think verse 3, that he upholds all things by the word of his power. So even the elements of creation, the universe itself, it's the word of God that is sustaining and is upholding it. So the earth is where it is, and it's not any closer to the sun. If it gets an inch closer to the sun, we probably will just be barbecued. And if it gets further an inch from the sun, we'll probably be frozen. But God's word is upholding it, telling it every course of universe where to stay. The Jupiter, the earth, what a joy, what a joy. He's also the Lord who is able to subdue all things to himself. Philippians 3:21. God is able. The Lord is the Lord who is able to subdue. That is, there's nothing that is beyond his ability to put under his will and his plan, as according to his divine economy. So we serve the Lord, the God that is inside of us, the Lord himself that is dwelling in us, is the Lord that is able to subdue all things to himself. And so what does this do to us as believers in Christ Jesus? I believe it gives us confidence, and it also encourages us in the place of intercession and prayers, because we are praying knowing fully well that the God we are serving and the God that is dwelling in us has all power to cause there to be a change of things in life, especially what we add value to humanity. He's also the Lord who has the preeminence in all things, Colossians chapter 1, the firstborn from the dead, the head of the church, is to have preeminence. Preeminence is to be the first, to have the first place in all things. That is, when God says he's having the first place, it means there's no room for second place. So in the eyes of God, there's first place, and every other person is just on the front rank of their own. So it doesn't mean, I mean, our world context, we have first, second, third. But in the eyes of God, to have preeminence is to have the say, the first and the final say in all things. What a joy to the Lord we are serving, the preeminence in all things. He's also the builder of all things. What does it mean as the builder of all things? In Hebrews chapter 3, that God is the builder of all things. Of course, there are two basic works of God, we could say essentially, His work in creation and His work in building. Having created the heavens and the earth, is now building His church, which He consummated in the New Jerusalem. And of course, we are the house of God. I believe we are the preoccupation of God's building. The Lord Himself is building our life. He said, He will build His church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. So it's also the builder of all things, going by Hebrews chapter 3, verse 4. God is the builder of all things, and we are the house of God, whose house we are if we hold fast our confidence. God is also the God of all flesh. And when we're talking about God, we are talking about, like Romans chapter 9, verse 5 say that about the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, who is God over us, bless God forever and ever. No, Romans chapter 9, verse 5 says of the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, Romans 9, verse 14, rather. No, not verse 14. Romans 9, verse 5. He says, whose are the fathers, and of whom concerning the flesh Christ came, who is over all, that is the Lord Jesus Christ, God bless forever. Amen. So God is the God of all flesh. I probably should have read Jeremiah 32:27, that behold, I am the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? So God is the God, I probably need to hold that because we'll be reading some of the scripture. So God is the God of all flesh, over all race, whether it's a Caucasian, an African, an Asian, no matter the human race, no human being created themselves. God is the God of all flesh. He gives us confidence as well. God is as well the God of all comfort. In any situation where we are in, God is able to give us comfort. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3 to 5. 2 Corinthians 1, 3 to 5. It says of the Lord, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, and the God of all comfort, who comfort us in all our tribulation, that we may enjoy, we may be able to comfort them that are in trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted by God. What a joy, what a joy. God is also the God of all grace. 1 Peter 5:10. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10. The God of all grace. 1 Peter 5 verse 10 say, but the God of all grace, who hath called us unto His eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that you have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen and settle you. So God is also the God of all grace, is the Spirit of grace as well. It's also the God of all power. That I've heard that power belongs to God. Once I've God spoken to us, I've heard that power belongs to God. But I could just take this from 1 Peter 5 since we're there. 11 says, to Him be dominion and to him be 1 Peter 5:11, to Him be glory and dominion forever. Some translation having to Him be glory and power forever and ever. Said that all power has been given unto me. I think Luke 10:19. And so God is the God of all power, whether it is spiritual power, electrical power, knowledge power. There are different types of power: technological power, there's financial power, there's spiritual power, there is economic power. All those realms of power, God has all of them. All power belongs to God, except the all the demonic power are subjected to Him. They are under His dominion, because all power has been given unto me, as the Lord said. It's also the God of all hope. Romans chapter 15 verse 13. Romans 15:13. God is the God of all hope. Hope is a positive expectation because of the Christ that is dwelling in us. That's why Christ in us, the hope of glory. Romans chapter 13, chapter 15, verse 13. Now the God of is in believing that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. So God is also the God of all hope. So the Lord, who is head over all things to the church, we can see this in Ephesians chapter 1. That Christ has been made head. God has made Christ the head of all things for the sake of the church. So there is nothing under the heavens that is not under the headship of Christ. It doesn't really mean that the powers of darkness, what they are doing, the devilish work they are doing, that Christ approves of it. When we stand in the place of prayer, He uses His authority and His sovereignty throughout the intercession of we, His body, to be able to carry out His will. So in places where we see certain things happening that are unpleasing, then I think we should take the blame that we are not doing enough prayers or as watchmen over certain territory. So the Lord is head over all things to the church for the sake of His church, for the benefit of His church. The God who has reconciled all things to Himself. Colossians chapter 1 verse 20. He has reconciled all things, not just human. It wasn't just man that fell when Adam disobeyed God. The whole creation needed to be reconciled to God. Colossians 1:20, and having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things. He didn't just say all men. All things unto himself by him. I say, whether they be things in heaven or whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. So even the blood of the Lord, like Hebrews 9 says, that the Lord Jesus Christ, having shed his blood, also cleansed the heavenly things themselves. So Adam's sin was not just over man alone, but the creation of God. And God has reconciled all things to himself through the blood of his Son. So it's also the God of all wisdom and knowledge. Colossians 2, verse 2, it says that. Verse 3, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. So God is the God of all wisdom and knowledge. No wisdom that we need in this world that we will accept devilish wisdom. God is the God of all wisdom. Financial wisdom, wisdom over our marital wisdom, wisdom over ruling a land, ruling a city, wisdom over running a company, running a corporation, running a family, wisdom over academics. God is the God of all wisdom. So all wisdom, the treasures of the wisdom and knowledge, wisdom is a treasure, knowledge is a treasure, understanding is a treasure. They are hidden in Christ, who is the mystery of God as well. So the God of all wisdom. So God is also the God of all nations. Psalm 86 verse 9. God is the God of all nations. All nations whom thou hast made shall come and worship before thee, O Lord, and shall glorify thy name. Regardless of where that nation is, it is by the hand of God that nation came into being, in the sense that nobody created himself on earth here. So man could boast over the fact that, oh, maybe in certain nations it's more of Islamic or some other religion. That doesn't negate the fact that God is the God that created all things. So it's also the God. He said all of the nations will come and bow before him. So some of them might not be bowing now technically, but they will ultimately bow to acknowledge the lordship of the Lord. He's also the ruler over the kings of the earth. Revelations 1:5. The ruler over the kings of the earth. Revelations 1:5. Ruler over the kings of the earth, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. So all the president, the prime ministers, the mayors, the local government chairman, the governors, or whatever title in any area of life where we are living in, Christ is ruler over the kings, over the leaders of this earth. What's our responsibility as members of his body? We are interceding, as our 1 Timothy 2 tells us. We are interceding for kings, for those who are in authority, so that we may live a peaceable and godly life. What a joy. He's also the God who that knows all things that are in the earth. 2 Samuel chapter 14 verse 20. He knows all things, nothing is hidden. To fetch about this form of speech that the servant Joab done this day, and my Lord is wise, according to the wisdom of an angel of God, to know all things that are in the earth. God is the true one that knows all things that are on the earth. The cattle on a thousand hills are his. He's also the God whom no creature, Hebrews 4, I think verse 12, is the God whom no creature is hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to his eyes. Is the word of God that is sharper than any two-edged sword. Nothing is hidden in his sight. So this gives us, again, boost our confidence. It gives us strength to know that the God we are serving and the God that dwells in us, nothing is hidden from his sight. Even if there's an accusation from somewhere or some unpleasant information is being passed across to a believer, to a church, to whoever, and to us in Christ, we are confident that, look, all things are open to the Lord, and God himself has a way whereby he retaliates in a good sense. That is, that he justifies his children, he vindicates his own. So all things are naked and open to his eyes. Also, the God from whom all things come, 1 Chronicles 29:14. It is from him all things come. What a joy. So 1 Chronicles 29:14. But who am I, and what is my people, that we should be able to offer so willingly after this song? For all things come of thee, and of thy own have we given have we given thee. And this was the adoration, of course, David was giving there to blessing God, that everything that God had done, what they were giving back to God was just a residue or remnant of what God had given to them. God gave them all things. So they are appreciating God that from God all things do come. How does this relate to me or to you and I in the New Testament? To just set our eyes on the Lord, that all things do come from Him. Whatever channel or resource, the resources are, the main source is God. Others are just resources or channels or means. It's a resource, it's not the main source. So we are always grateful and keeping our eyes upon Him, from whom all things come. It's also the God who made heaven, the heavens and the heavens and their host, the earth and all things that are on it. Nehemiah 9:6. We kind of have shortened that because of the space we have there. Nehemiah chapter 9 verse 6. Nehemiah 9:6. It said, Thou, even thou art Lord alone. Thou art made the heaven of the heavens with all their hosts, the earth and all things that are therein, the sea and all that is therein. And thou art preserved them all, and the host of heaven worship thee. It's talking about the supremacy and the majesty of our God. Everything on the sea, on the earth, in the heavens, God that made them. The God who has put all things under His feet. He put all things under the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ. And because we are now members of His body, so all things are now being made subjected under Him. What a joy. What a joy that there is nothing that is, nothing stands on the same level with our Lord. He is God over all things, over all situation, over any sickness, over any challenge, over any issue of life. Let's come to that conclusion that He's been given a name that is above every other name, that His name, at the mention of His name, every knee shall bow. So we are not just worshiping or serving a God that is almost like there are certain areas of life that He doesn't have, He can't subdue to Himself. So this is what fuels our thanksgiving and our prayers to God. The God who performs all things for His children. Psalm 57 verse 2. He performs all things for His children. I will cry out to the Lord Most High, unto God that performed all things for me. So we are glad about it, that we have a God that is working in us both to will and to do for His good pleasure, that we are never without help. I don't think we are never without help. We could be blind to certain things or certain perception of God or of how much God longs to help us, but that doesn't negate the fact that we are never without help. The Lord who made all things for Himself. Psalm 16 verse 4. He made all things for Himself. What a joy. Psalm 16 verse 4. That sorrows shall be multiplied, that hasting after another God, gotten drunk by their drink offering, will I not offer? I think I probably have the wrong scriptures on that. Let me just check that. That God makes all things for Himself. What a joy to the God we serve, the God that made everything. Nothing is outside of His control. All things were made by Him, for Him. He created all things for Himself. In the past, in the future, God has made all things for Himself. I probably had the wrong scripture there, but of course, in the sense that God has made all things for Himself, all things were made by Him. So they were created, and there's the Revelation part, which is the last one we finished with, Revelation 4:11, that all things were created for His pleasure. What a joy to our risen Lord. The God who formed all things, Proverbs 29:26-10. God is the God that formed all things for Himself. Proverbs 26 verse 10. He formed all things for Himself. It says, and the great God that formed all things, both new, both rewarded the fool and rewarded the transgression. So He formed all things for Himself. He's also the maker. He's the God who makes all things. Isaiah 44:24. Thus saith the Lord thy Redeemer, he that formed thee from the womb, I am the Lord that maketh all things, the God that maketh all things, that stretcheth forth the heavens alone, that spreadeth abroad the earth by itself. Is the Lord that makes all things. He's also the maker of all things. Some might say that, oh, it seems to be repetitive, that God repeats himself as many times, because how do we learn? We learn by repetition. So God is the one that keeps saying it. And these are not even all of them. These are just a few of them. God keeps mentioning it and hammering it so that it will sink into us. Jeremiah 10 verse 16, the portion of Jacob is not like them, for he is the former of all things, and Israel is the rod of his inheritance. The Lord of hosts is his name. Some translation have it as the maker of all things, or the former of all things, the God with whom all things are possible. Matthew 19:26, with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. So there is no such thing as impossibility before God. He is the specialist of all specialists. There is no situation if we ever refer to another specialist, oh, this one is more than me, let's go. No, everything has its dead end in God. There is nothing that will go, there is nothing that God will ever refer to anyone. Is the authority, is the final say on any issue. Everything bows to him. They don't even dare stand with their two legs before him. If they are two-legged creatures, they bow before the Lord. What a joy. That's the God we serve. All things are possible with him. It's also the God who makes all things work together for our good to them that love him. Romans chapter 8, all things, Romans 8:26-28, that God is the God that makes all things work together for good for those who love him. So no matter that situation, no matter how unpleasant or however it may look, let's, even in our mistakes, as long as we are repentant and we have a meek spirit before the Lord, a humble spirit, God will make it work together for our good. We walk in love, we intercede, God will cause that situation to work together for our good, because it's God. Is God. Everything, all the elements of creation bows to his authority. Is the God who freely gives all things that pertain to life and godliness. You can take this from Romans 8:32, that if he wouldn't spare his son, how much more will he freely give us all things? Also, I think 2 Peter chapter 1, that God is God that gives us all things that pertain to life and godliness. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 3, according as his divine power had given unto us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him that has called us unto glory and virtue. So he freely gives us all things that pertain to life and godliness, to the redeemed of the Lord. What a joy. Also, and all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ. All things are of God. He has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ. So there's nothing for us as believers in Christ. There's nothing good we need that God doesn't have. He's the source of it. He has different channels. He has different means. He has different means of getting it. And this is why we come in the place of adoration, in the place of thanksgiving, in the place of prayer. That's why I said in Philippians 4 that once we have made our request known to him, we do what? That we present our thanksgiving, we make our request to him, and with thanksgiving, he will keep our hearts at peace. What a joy that we bring our supplication. Let me even read Philippians 4, 8, Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, we start from verse 6 actually. From verse 6, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your heart and mind through Jesus Christ. Also, all things are done according to his plan. Ephesians 1:11, that all things are done according to his plan. That is, according to his plans and decision. What God has predestined, God ultimately works towards it to make sure it comes to pass. This actually gives us confidence. As a child of God, I look at it that all things in my life, all things in the life of you as a child of God, are done according to his plan. That is, there's a confidence. We are not trying to figure out a blueprint for our life. We're not trying to carve out a vision. I know this is so circulated. I mean, it's a common thing around the world whereby, okay, what's the vision for your life? If they mean it in the sense that have you gotten your vision from God? We don't craft a vision for our life per se. We didn't create ourselves. This interactive projector, the iPad, they didn't create themselves. There was something that created it, or someone that a manufacturer. So we go back to God, and we are with that confidence, we are thanking him, we are praying to him. Ephesians 1, 16, 17, 18, that the eyes of our understanding may be enlightened to know the hope of his calling for our life. Also, he predestined us according to the purpose. This is still Ephesians 1 verse 11 from another translation. The initial one was from the Good News translation. This is, I think, from the New King James. Being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will. So God works all things according to the counsel of his will. In my life, I lay hold of this. I see this in scripture and I'm glad about it. I'm rejoicing and thanking him that, Lord, you are working all things according to the counsel of your plan for my life, for my family, for your church, for our nation, I mean for the body of Christ, for my fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. So that, because I don't know, it's a challenge. It's almost an impossible task for someone to just come and just craft out a vision for their life absence of God. They didn't create themselves, whether they know God or they don't know God. God created every one of us. So we go back to him and thank him for working all things according to his plan. The Lord who descended, Ephesians chapter 4, that the same Lord who descended and then ascended that he might fill all things with himself. So it's the Lord that first descended, that is the Word became flesh, and as now ascend, the one that descended is the one that has now ascended far above the heavens that he might fill all things with himself. Let me read that. Ephesians chapter 4, I think from verse 10 or thereabout. Ephesians 4, it says that, Ephesians 4, let me read from verse 9. Now that he that descended, or from verse 8. Wherefore he said, when he ascended up high, he led captivity captive and gave gift to men. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower part of the earth? Verse 10. That he that descended is the same also that ascended far above all heavens that he might fill all things. What a joy. That's why the church fathers came up with the term the pneumatic Christ, the Christ that fills all things. Pneuma means air. The God who created all things by Jesus Christ. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 9. And to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world had been hidden in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. So he created all things by the Lord Jesus Christ. Is the God unto whom we give thanks for all things. Ephesians 5:20. We give thanks for all things. So God is the God of all things. God is the God over all things. God has supremacy, sovereignty. Yes, some might say that, oh yeah, everybody knows that. Yeah, everybody might know, but not everybody is thanking him. I don't think we're thanking him the way, or being cognizant and being conscious of that ever before him too, because there's a joy that comes to it when you know you are in union with someone that has authority and supremacy over all things. Ephesians 5 verse 20, it says, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. For all things we're giving thanks unto him. He created all things that are in heaven and that are on earth. And this probably we'll be taking this from Colossians chapter 1. That great eulogy of about the Lord Jesus Christ. All things were made by him. So he created all things. Colossians chapter 1, maybe from verse 16. For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominion, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. So you can see the preposition, they were created by him, they were created for him. So is the goal of the of everything that was created. They were created by him means that is the means through which they were created. So what a joy that the God we are serving is the God that made all things visible, invisible. That means not everything that we even see, not everything created that we see. Some are invisible, and God is the creator of all. Also in that Colossians 1, it's still verse 18, it says, is before all things, and by him, 17:18, and by him all things consist. That is, all things have their, they have their proper position in him. Outside of him, they can never sustain themselves. The sun cannot sustain itself without the Lord, whereby being in coherence with the Lord. Coherence in the terms of like, they take the spokes of a wheel. You take the spokes away, the wheels will fall off. So they have their sustainability because of the fact that they were created by God and they maintain their position in the rightful place God has put. The sea will not outflow where God has not allowed it to overflow. So it's before all things, nothing was before him, and by him all things consist. They have their proper position. The God who gives life to all things, 1 Timothy 6, verse 13, 1 Timothy 6, verse 13. He quickeneth all things. On some translation put it there, I give thee charge in the sight of God, who quickeneth all things. I'm reading from the New King James, and some other translation as it as quickening means to give life. Who quickeneth all things, and before Jesus Christ, who before Pontius Pilate witness a good confession. Also is the living God who gives us richly all things to enjoy. Still 1 Timothy 6, verse 17. Charge them also that are rich in this world, that they may not be high-minded, nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God who gives us richly all things to enjoy. So today we are looking at God over all things, God of all things, just the supremacy of God, to make us to see that the God we are serving, He gives us all things to richly enjoy. Those of us His children in the Lord, God gives things to, whether He causes rain to fall on the just or the unjust. But when it comes to certain things, the scripture lets us to know, like some of the things that the people, He makes all things work together for our good. For example, He freely gives us all things because He didn't hold back His Son from us. The Lord who gives understanding in all things. 2 Timothy 2:7. Consider what I say, and the Lord will give you understanding in all things. So in any situation where we are in any area of life, we have a challenge. And almost if someone says every problem is a wisdom problem. If you have the wisdom concerning a problem, you have authority over that problem. Is no longer a problem, it just becomes a testimony. And so God is the God that gives understanding over all things. So this draws us back for Him as a spirit. Maybe that's why Ephesians 1, the prayer, that He will open the eyes of our understanding to know the hope of His calling. So we go to God knowing full well that the Lord is able to give us understanding in all things. What a joy to the God we serve. The Lord from whom are all things, and by whom are all things. Hebrews chapter 2, that from Him are all things, and by, I think Hebrews 2:10, from whom are all things, and by whom are all things. What a joy. Hebrews 2 verse 10, for it became Him for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons into glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. What a joy. The God that should be glorified in all things. 1 Peter 4:11. In all things, God should be glorified. It says, if any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. And if any man minister, let him do so as the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. That God be glorified in all things. The God who knows all things. 1 John 3:20. The God that knows all things, nothing is hidden from Him. For if our heart condemn us, God is greater than our heart and knoweth all things. He knows what is in the heart of man. What a joy. The Lord God who created all things for His pleasure. Revelation 4:11. All things were created for His pleasure. The song in Revelation, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive all the glory. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. For thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they were created. So all things were created for His pleasure. What a joy. The God who created all things for His pleasure. What a joy. The God who will make all things new. Revelation 21:5. In the new Jerusalem, He will make all things new. Behold, I make all things new. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And He said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. So He makes all things new for us. This is the day the Lord has made. We'll be glad and rejoice in Him. For of Him and through Him and to Him are all things. Romans chapter 11 verse 36. Romans 11 verse 36. Through Him and unto Him are all things. For of Him and through Him. The first started from verse 33. Oh, the depth of both the riches of both the... Oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and the knowledge of God. How unsearchable are His judgment and His ways past finding out. For who hath known the mind of the Lord? Or who hath been His counselor? And who hath first given to Him? And it shall be recompensed unto Him again. Verse 36, for of Him and through Him and to Him are all things, to whom be glory forever and ever. But to us, 1 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 6. But to us there is but one God. And here was when Paul was talking in the brethren in Corinth. about meat sacrifice to idols and what have you, and he was trying to encourage the brothers there that it is of God, that but there's only one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we in him, and our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. Just to encourage them that they should not be afraid of this pagan's worship, or have their conscience being weakened by the fact that maybe some of the meats they were buying for the market were offered to idols. So those gods are no God. There's only one God. But there is one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and by him, and we in him. So we are in him, and one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. So we are in him, and we are also by Jesus Christ. So this just gives confidence to the brethren that no matter what the occultic ones are doing, let's not lose sight of the fact that all their powers, every one of them is subject to the authority of Christ. It's when we are not aware of this, that's when some of the things they are doing, we get us scared unnecessarily. The spirit of fear, Satan, we use that. But when we are aware of it, that we are of God, and he has put us into Christ, and we are by Christ, and we by him. What a joy. It gives us confidence. Again, going back to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 6, that one God and Father who is over all, through all, and in you all. What a joy. So today we've been able to look at the God over all things, the God of all things. We just looked at those dual topics, so it's the same in a sense, not the same, but God over all things. There's also God of all things. Basically, the key word all things are God's supremacy, God's authority, God's sovereignty over things over on the earth here, that all things were made by him. For without him was nothing made that was made. All things were created by God. One God and Father who is over all, through all, and in you all. And it also now says that in 1 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 6, that but to us there's but one God and the Father, of whom are all things. So this gives us confidence. Is the God of all flesh, the God of all nations, the God of all wisdom, the God of all grace, the God of all hope, the God of all comfort, the God that there is no impossibility within, the God of all possibility. This makes us to rejoice. This makes us to appreciate him. Our heart is full of thanksgiving to him, and we by him, and we in him, and our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. So in every part of our life, the God that deserves all the glory, he has given us richly all things that pertain to life and godliness. He gives us all things richly to enjoy. What a joy to this loving Father. Hallelujah to God over all things. Hallelujah to the God of all things. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.